On behalf of everyone here, thank you for having them sing another song. And Dr. Moeller, thank you for that kind introduction. You're correct that it does take a certain amount of hubris to name your church Paramount Baptist Church, but I will note it also takes a certain amount of hubris to name your seminary the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. That's what you call building rapport with your audience. Is that right, Dr. York? Truly, Dr. Moeller, it's an honor to be here and a joy. Thank you for having me here. It's good to be home. I'm a child of Southern Seminary. I graduated from an institution whose namesake was Dr. W.A. Criswell, who graduated from this institution twice. And when I attended, was led by Jerry Johnson, who graduated from Southern Seminary with his PhD and was the dean of Boyce College and served in other ways here. And so it seems inevitable somehow that I would be beamed back to the mothership and do my doctoral work here, but it was a great privilege to come and study here. Have so many friends here. Denny Burke, who taught my first class of my first course in Bible college at Criswell, hermeneutics. And Michael Wilder, who was my doctoral supervisor, and David Prince and Adam Greenway, who've been such good friends. It's a joy to be back on this campus. I'm going to invite you to take your copy of God's Word and turn to the book of Romans and chapter 8. The Gospel for the Seminarian. Martin Luther, who died 471 years ago this past Saturday, in his commentary on the Epistle to the Galatians said that the gospel is the principal article of all Christian doctrine. We should know this article well, teach it unto others, and beat it into their heads continually. Well, I'm going to try to beat the gospel into your heads a little this morning. If you're in this room, likely you're preparing for a lifetime of ministry, or perhaps you're already in ministry. And I want you to know that as much as any lost person that you know, you need the gospel. The gospel is not just how you enter the Christian life, it's how you endure in the Christian life and ultimately make it to the end of the Christian life. And if you're planning on going into ministry, you need to know that the gospel is going to be as important to you as the very oxygen that you breathe. Because life in the ministry is a life that can be filled with condemnation. Even though it was 5 years ago, I remember him whispering it in my ear as if it happened yesterday. You don't deserve to be a pastor. In 2012, I was called to serve a former church now. And in the weeks between the Sunday that I was called as pastor and the Sunday that I began to serve as pastor, I went through what was then the most difficult spiritual attack of my life. I heard the enemy whisper it again and again. You aren't qualified. You're a failure. If people knew who you really are, they would never follow you. You don't have what it takes. The accusations of the enemy were relentless. And the truth is, this kind of accusation and sense of condemnation doesn't come only from Satan. You can feel it coming from church members. As pastors and those in ministry, we're often under expectations, sometimes voiced, sometimes unvoiced, often silently judged by how many people walk the aisle, which visits we made or missed, how well we preached, whether or not we showed up at the hospital or that birthday party. One of the hardest parts of pastoring is feeling like you're constantly being judged, but the measure of judgment is never quite fully known. And this condemnation can weigh on your life and burden you down. Life and ministry is full of condemnation. And listen, when you hear the accusing voice of a crabby church member or the bony finger of accusation is pointed at you by the enemy, you can respond by being despondent, by being depressed, by getting defensive. I've done all of those things. So often my self-worth is wrapped up in feelings of achievement. You feel like you have to defend yourself. to church members or else walk around just feeling crushed all the time. But I want to encourage you, Southern Seminary, that when those accusations come your way, instead of being despondent or depressed or defensive, to be dependent on Jesus. To find your rest and refuge from condemnation, find your shelter from accusation in the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to front the point this morning. I have one point to give you this morning from Romans chapter 8, and that's this. The gospel tells us that no word of condemnation can be spoken over you that has not already been forgiven at the cross. And here's what that means. When Satan says that you're unworthy, you can agree with him. But then you remind him that Christ is worthy and that you're hidden in Christ. When he says you're not qualified, you're right. If people knew who you really are, they wouldn't follow you. You're right. You're a failure. You're right. But Jesus isn't. Students and faculty, in those moments of accusation and condemnation, you've got to preach the gospel to yourself. Life in the ministry is a life sometimes filled with condemnation, but if you will root your life and ministry in the gospel, you can be free from all condemnation. My acceptability to God is based on Christ's performance and not my own. And Satan would be right if my salvation and my calling were based on my performance. But listen, I'm declared acceptable to God on the basis of nothing less than the merit of Christ and his performance on my behalf. So I want to share with you for a few moments my favorite verse in the Bible, Romans chapter 8 and verse 1, what has been called the inner sanctuary within the cathedral of Christian faith. And I want to encourage you this morning to find your refuge from condemnation in Jesus. Romans chapter 8 and verse 1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. Romans chapter 8 verse 1 comes, of course, as part of a larger discourse unit, but I'm going to offer just a few reflections on the very first verse of this section. I'm going to preach what is essentially a one-point message this morning, really one part of one larger message. Now, there's strategy to that. If you like this one part of the message, then maybe Dr. Moeller will have me back another time to finish the message sometime. But I want to take one major truth from God's word and just camp out there. Something I always want to do in my church is sometimes just get to a place and just stop and marinate. And that's what I'm going to do this morning. I want to take one point and hold it up to the light and turn it around a few different ways. And my goal this morning is simply to administer the gospel to you like medicine. Father, take the truth of this text and drive it deep into our hearts. Amen. I want you to see first this morning the reality of forgiveness. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. As you know, the "there is" implied in the text. Literally, this reads, "Now, therefore, no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus." This is a statement of fact. If you are in Christ, there is no word of condemnation that can be spoken over you. You can be forgiven. And Romans chapter 8, verse 1, in my view, is a restatement, essentially, of Romans chapter 5 and verse 1, that therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And Romans 5, 1 is a word of good news because of what the Apostle Paul has been saying up to this point. In Romans chapter 1, there is a startling declaration in chapter 1, verse 18, where the Apostle Paul says that God's wrath is revealed from heaven against all godlessness and unrighteousness. And then Paul lists what unrighteousness looks like in the rest of chapter 1. And if you're a first century reader, part of the church in Rome, you might be listening to Paul and listening to all of these things. The fact that the culture, the world, that those who are living unrighteous lives exchange the truth of God for a lie or worship and serve that which is created rather than the Creator. And you might be tempted, if you're a member of the church at Rome, to look at the culture out there and point the finger and say, yes, God's wrath should be revealed against them. Against all of those unrighteous people. Paul gives you chapter 2. And he says, be careful, those of you who judge, because in judging those out there, you actually are doing the very same things as those that you are judging. So in chapter 3, he concludes that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That there's no one righteous, no, not one. So the big question of the book of Romans is, how can I be made right with God? And Paul moves on in chapter 4 to say that you are made righteous, you're declared righteous, you're justified, not according to your works, but by faith in the work of Jesus on your behalf. And he concludes that in Romans chapter 5, verse 1, where he says, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God. That means that the hostility between us and God has ceased. The warfare has ended. That through faith in the finished work of Christ, this wrath of God, which we deserve for our sin, is no longer ours to bear, that we can have peace with God. Now, chapter 5 then transitions to talk about the results of our justification by faith. We have things like peace with God and access to God and joy in hope and joy even in trial and so on and so forth. In chapter 6, Paul talks about one of the results of justification by faith being that we have freedom from slavery to sin. But then in chapter 7, Paul introduces another idea, and that is that those who are justified by faith can still be trapped by sin. You know the very familiar passage in Romans chapter 7 where Paul says, the things I want to do, I don't do. The things I don't want to do, I find myself doing. And many of us have been there. We've been justified by faith. We've come to Jesus. We've been saved from our sin, and yet we still find ourselves living in sometimes those same patterns of sin, sometimes bound up by those things that had us before we knew Christ. I don't know about you, but I've been there where I wonder, okay, I've trusted Christ, I've been justified, but now I continue to sin. I resonate with what Paul says in Romans chapter 7, so is God gonna pour out his wrath on me? And sometimes, even though we've been justified by faith, we can worry about our sanctification and wonder that maybe God's wrath will come even upon the believer. And even though we may know otherwise, we feel guilt and remorse for our sin and regret, and we're sometimes fearful that God will pour out his wrath on us, even though we've been justified by faith. So we come to Romans chapter 8 and verse 1. Right after Paul says that it's possible, even in being justified, that you can still be caught up sometimes in sin. That even then, if you're in Christ, there is no condemnation for you. There is a reality of forgiveness. Paul restates what he said already in chapter 5, verse 1. You can have peace with God. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ. That's a forensic statement. The sentence of death, which is rightly ours because of our sin, will not be carried out. Instead of condemnation, through the work of Christ, we get clemency. Now think about it. That time you spoke out of spite in your small group, forgiven. That time you spoke behind someone's back, forgiven. That hospital visit that you forgot to make, forgiven. That time that you stretched the truth in order to make yourself look better, in Christ, forgiven. That time you felt jealous at another person's success, forgiven. Brothers and sisters, forgiveness is real. The truth is, many of us think that either we don't need forgiveness or that we've failed so miserably that there is no way that God could forgive us. I want you to hear the words of C.S. Lewis, who wrote an essay entitled On Forgiveness. Lewis said this, I find that when I think I'm asking God to forgive me, I'm often in reality asking him to do something quite different. I'm asking him not to forgive me, but to excuse me. But there's all the difference in the world between forgiving and excusing. Forgiveness says, yes, you have done this thing, but I accept your apology, and I'll never hold it against you, and everything between us two will be exactly as it was before. But excusing says, I see that you couldn't help it. Or didn't mean it. You weren't really to blame. If one was not really to blame, then there's nothing to forgive. In that sense, forgiveness and excusing are almost opposites. The trouble is that what we call asking God's forgiveness very often really consists in asking God to accept our excuses. And if we forget this, we shall go away imagining that we have repented and been forgiven, when all that has really happened is that we have satisfied ourselves with our own excuses. The remedy is really and truly to believe in the forgiveness of sins. A great deal of our anxiety to make excuses comes from not really believing in it, from thinking that God will not take us to himself again unless he's satisfied that some sort of case can be made out in our favor. But that would not be forgiveness at all. Real forgiveness means looking steadily at the sin that is left over without any excuse after all allowances have been made, and seeing it in all of its horror and dirt and meanness and malice, and nevertheless being wholly reconciled to the man who has done it. That, and only that, is forgiveness. And that we can always have from God if we ask for it. Listen, friends, in light of our sin and the reality of God's wrath that is revealed against sin, real forgiveness is what we need. And in Christ, real forgiveness is what we have. Hostilities have ceased. The warfare between us and God is over. Forgiveness is real. Now let's take this truth, hold it in the light, and turn it a little. I want you to see not only the reality of forgiveness, but I want you to see the extent of forgiveness. Look at what Paul says again, Romans 8:1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation. How much condemnation? No condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And Paul is emphasizing this. He moves Uden, the word no, up to the front of the sentence, which is a little bit of an unusual construction here. He's trying to emphasize, I think, the extent of our forgiveness. Listen, forgiveness is not partial. Forgiveness is not conditional. Forgiveness is not temporary. Forgiveness is not probationary. We have complete forgiveness. To the extent that Christ is acceptable, you are acceptable. Now listen to this. The extent of your forgiveness is directly proportionate to the extent of the sufficiency of Christ's death. I recently finished preaching through the book of Hebrews, and the author of Hebrews, Luke, says that, I just want to throw that in there, says that after making atonement, Jesus sat down. Now listen, you stand when there's more work to do. You sit when the work has been done. The atonement is finished. All of your sins have been atoned for, past, present, and future, which means that you're accepted by God not merely in justification, but also in sanctification and ultimately in glorification. I mean, it's not like you get justified by Christ's work, but then your ongoing acceptance is based on your work. Sometimes it feels that way. I understand that to be justified, to be acceptable God in justification, I have to depend on Christ. But now it's up to me to pull myself up by my own moral bootstraps, to put on the big S Superman, you know, super Christian t-shirt and cape, and I'm going to go strive and do all the right things and not do all the wrong things. I'm not going to drink and chew and go with the girls who do and all of those types of things. And that by my own work, my ongoing acceptability to God will be based on my performance. That's not the way that it works. You're made acceptable to God in justification and sanctification and glorification on the basis of what Christ has done. The extent of your acceptance and forgiveness is unlimited because the sufficiency of Christ's work on the cross is sufficient to pay for all of your sins. I grew up in a legalistic church for a few years in an independent Baptist church. I'm talking about the real kind. You know, the King James Bible-believing, chicken-eating, gun-toting, sin-hating, sinner-loving, pew-jumping, all of those kinds, that kind of Baptist church. Sometimes it felt as if my ongoing acceptance before God was based on my effort. That's why this little word no is so important. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. Christ's death is sufficient to pay for all of my sins. Dr. Moeller mentioned that my wife Amy and I have four young children. When people see that we have that many, they often ask us if we have a television. And we say, yes, but we don't watch it very often. And then they'll say things like, do you know how that happens? And we say, yes, that's why we have so many children. And we had this minivan to hold all of the kids. And as our family began to grow, our minivan, which we called our swagger wagon, was no longer large enough to hold the whole family. And so what happened over time is that the van began to fall apart, and it became a money hole. We just had to keep throwing money at this thing, and it wasn't large enough. And at a certain point, my patience with this ugly beater van was, it ran out, and I was done. And I decided I wasn't going to keep the van anymore. I would only put up with it for so long. At a certain point, my commitment to the van was limited. When I determined that the cost exceeded the value, I was just going to get rid of it. Listen, God's patience never runs out on us. There's never a point at which he decides that the cost exceeds the value, because his commitment to his son is unlimited. That means that the extent of your forgiveness is unlimited if you're in Christ. You know the culmination of Romans chapter 8. We see at the end in verse 35 a question. What then are we to say about these things? At verse 35, who can separate us from the love of Christ? And then the answer in verse 38 and 39, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. There is no condemnation for those in Christ. Now let's take that truth and let's turn it in the light one last time. I want you to see finally this morning not just the reality of forgiveness and the extent of forgiveness. I want you to see the basis of forgiveness. Look at what Paul says, Romans chapter 8, verse 1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. We teach our children that Noah's family was safe from the flood because they were in the ark. And Paul says here that if you're in Christ, you are safe from the storm of God's judgment. And Paul is going to root our forgiveness in two different aspects of Christ's work. First, he roots our forgiveness in Christ's victory over sin, which we see in the immediate preceding context. If you look down at chapter 7, there's a conundrum that's introduced in verse 19. Verse 19, for I do not do the good that I want to do, but I practice the evil that I do not want to do. That's what I've introduced to you already. But then he asks a question down in verse 24. Paul says, what a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body of death? That's the question. Verse 25 is the answer. But thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Here's what Paul is saying. We are trapped in our sin and in need of rescue, and Jesus is our Christus victor. Therefore, chapter 8, verse 1, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. In other words, because of the victory that God has won through Christ, chapter 7, chapter 8, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. How can you be free from condemnation? Because Jesus is a warrior who has destroyed the power of sin and will one day deliver us from the very presence of sin. Now, don't miss this. Dr. Tom Schreiner, in his exquisite commentary on the book of Romans, and you must understand what an intimidating thing it is to open up the book of Romans in the presence of Dr. Tom Schreiner. But Dr. Schreiner makes a great point about this section. Notice the tense of the terms here. Paul says, who will rescue me? See, talking about past, present, or future here. Future. Who will rescue me? But then look in chapter 8, verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation. Listen, we look forward to a future rescue from this body of death that will come when Jesus returns, but we get to enjoy the benefits of this future reign of Christ in the here and now. It's as if the future has broken into the present. Jesus will deliver us from sin, but we already enjoy the benefits of this future rescue that has not yet fully come. Because of the victorious work of Jesus, we're free from condemnation and we can have forgiveness. Now, but there's a second aspect of Christ's work that Paul roots our forgiveness in, and that is Christ's, not just his victory on the cross, but his substitutionary work on the cross. In verse 1, there's this declaration that there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, But in verses 2 through 4, you have a justification for that statement. Verses 2 through 4 provide the grounds for the statement in verse 1. Paul's going to ground that declaration that there's no condemnation in the substitutionary work of Christ. And I want you to look with me in verses 2 through 4 and just notice the language of substitution. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus because the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. In other words, there's a principle, there's a law that when you sin, it results in death. But there's another law. It's the law of the Spirit of life that subverts the previous law. And then verse 3, what the law could not do since it was weakened by the flesh, God did. He condemned sin in the flesh, look at this, by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh as a sin offering in order that the law's requirement would be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh but according to the Spirit. Christ's performance gains our forgiveness. What you could not accomplish in your flesh, Jesus accomplished for you, on your behalf. The law's requirement was not accomplished by us, but in us by him. That's the gospel. Because Jesus received God's judgment as a sin offering, you can receive God's mercy. Because Jesus went to the cross as your substitute, he took the condemnation for you. You can now be free from condemnation. Another way of putting this is this. You can receive God's favor because Jesus received God's wrath. Psalm 75 talks about a cup filled with God's wrath that all the wicked will drink, draining it to the dregs. I think that that's what Jesus is referring to in the Garden of Gethsemane when he says, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. What did Jesus see in that cup? He saw God's wrath for our sin. Hebrews chapter 2 says, he tasted death for everyone. Jesus did not merely sip the cup. He drank it until it was dry. The gospel tells us that Jesus drained the cup of God's wrath to the very dregs. And here's what that means for you. If you are united to Christ by faith, God has no more wrath left for you. The cup is empty. There's no more wrath to drink. That's not because there isn't wrath or because you don't deserve it, but because we have an advocate, a defender, who stands in front of us and receives all of the wrath of God for us in our place. He drinks our cup for us. Listen, we don't have forgiveness because condemnation doesn't exist. That's what you would hear if you attended the First Church of Oprah. We have forgiveness because although condemnation exists, someone took it for you. You see, forgiveness always costs something. It's not like God can just decide he's not going to have wrath. God's judgment has to be paid. If you assault my reputation For me to forgive you costs me something. It means I'm willing to absorb the hurt and the insult in order to extend you forgiveness. Listen, God's condemnation had to be dealt with. The gospel is that Jesus dealt with it for you. Jesus absorbed the wrath of God in your place. In my place, condemned, he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. We've had 4 children, I've told you that. Our 3rd child is Mackenzie. She's a redhead. She's full of life, and she's tiny. A couple of years ago, we had a large dog, not like the president's dog, Baxter. We had a large dog, about a 95-pound black lab German Shepherd mix, and the dog was wild and crazy. And I remember one particular afternoon, our back door had been left open, which is often the case, and I saw our little, she was about 2 at that time, our little 2-year-old Mackenzie standing in the doorway. And then beyond Mackenzie, out in the backyard, I saw Zoe, our dog. She was full of life. You're taking Greek, you'll catch that in a second. I saw Zoe in the backyard, and it was like this whole thing just slowed down. I could see it in slow motion. The dog began to turn her head and notice that the door to the house was open. And you could just see her eyes kind of pop wide open. And she begins to run inside the house, and it's like a slow motion train wreck about to happen. I see the 95-pound dog and the 20-pound little redheaded girl, dog, girl, dog, girl, dog, girl, and I'm about to see my daughter, you know, just absolutely decimated by this beast of a dog, and I have one moment to do something, and so I just grab my daughter, and I sweep her up like this, and I turn, and that dog just barrels right over the top of me. I absorbed the brunt of that dog's wrath. And I saved my daughter. Isn't that incredible? And my daughter was safe from the dog because she was hidden in my arms. Now that's the beauty of the good news of Jesus. Here's what the gospel is. God turns his wrath, which we deserve because of our sin, in upon himself, in the death of his son Jesus on the cross, so that Jesus takes the brunt of the wrath of God. And if you are hidden in Christ, you are safe from the wrath of God. So that God's wrath is satisfied and we receive clemency. At the cross, God satisfies what God himself demands. And so we have life because Jesus drank death. Because Jesus received the wrath of God's justice, we can receive the wealth of God's grace. And so whenever you feel abandoned by God and accused by the enemy, you can know it's just a feeling. The Father abandoned the Son on the cross so that he would never have to abandon you. And if you're in Christ, the weight of God's judgment is no longer yours to bear. The cup of condemnation is empty. Everything that can be condemned in your life has already been judged in Jesus, which means that the worst thing that could happen to you has already happened. Your sin has been judged fully at the cross. And the best thing that could happen to you has also happened at the cross. You've been justified. In Christ, you are both judged and justified at the cross. So let me close by saying this. Just come in close for a minute. Because I know that some of you in this room are extremely burdened. Even as a seminary student or faculty member, as someone in ministry or preparing for ministry, feelings of failure, guilt, jealousy, whatever, can come upon you even as you're in this environment. I mean, you're around so many people who love the Lord and may appear to be more faithful than you, or more effective in ministry than you, or more naturally gifted than you, and maybe it seems as if they don't struggle with sin like you do. And the enemy, who is so wily, can even use the good purpose of studying at seminary to speak a word of condemnation and accusation over you. Jesus died for that. And you are accepted by him because of what Jesus has done for you. You're not accepted because you obey. You're accepted so that you can obey. And if you feel guilty because you haven't done enough for God, or you feel like you're not good enough, realize Christ can lift that burden. The gospel is not about how much you can do for God, but about how much God has done for you in Christ. Charity Bancroft put it this way: when Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there who made an end of all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. There is no condemnation for you in Christ. God is as pleased with you as he can possibly be because of Jesus. And that's a gospel reality that will transform the motivation that you have for sticking it out in seminary or in ministry. We don't work for God's favor, but from God's favor. The pressure is off to be Jesus 2.0. Jesus is sufficient. He succeeded in every way that you failed. So rest in that and rejoice in that today. C.S. Lewis wrote the Chronicles of Narnia, and there's a beautiful scene I love so much. You know the story of Narnia, this land ruled over by an evil white witch. There's a true king, Aslan, and he's coming. But in the meantime, there's this warfare, there's this rebellion going on. And there are these children who enter into the land of Narnia, and one of them, his name is Edmund, and the evil white witch gets him to become a traitor, a turncoat, against his own family, because he tastes something called Turkish delight, and he wants more of it. So he rats out his family. Well, the story continues, and Edmund ends up getting captured by the witch, but Aslan rescues Edmund. There's this beautiful scene where Edmund goes and meets with Aslan, and he gets forgiven. Later, the evil white witch comes to the camp to meet with Aslan. And this is how Lewis depicts it. Though it was bright sunshine, everyone felt suddenly cold. The only two people present who seemed to be quite at their ease were Aslan and the witch herself. It was the oddest thing to see those two faces, the golden face and the dead white face, so close together. Not that the witch looked Aslan exactly in his eyes. Mrs. Beaver particularly noticed this. "You have a traitor there, Aslan," said the witch. Of course, everyone present knew that she meant Edmund. But Edmund had got past thinking about himself after all he'd been through and after the talk he'd had that morning. Edmund just went on looking at Aslan, and it didn't seem to matter what the witch said. Listen, friend, when you experience accusation, just keep looking at Jesus, and it won't matter what the witch says.